It's a celebration. What up, everybody? Welcome to Retro Gaming's Most Dangerous Podcast. Nate here.
Lester.
The first one of season six. Welcome back, buddy.
Thank you.
While you weren't
I'm alive.
Resurrection. We'll do a video at the end. I have an idea for a video. We recently shot our season six return to YouTube. My coffee's still hot. And Lester wasn't able to come with us, actually.
No, I had to help my aunt move.
Yeah.
All day.
And it was hard to be peppy that day. Just saying.
Yeah.
Welcome to our setup here. I don't know if they're always going to be like this, but Lester and I are going to probably do a podcast at least twice a month, I think.
That's cool.
Because yeah, you'll be at Brittany's house every...
Yeah, I'm always there.
Yeah, so at least twice a month, we'll be here. And Retro Gaming's Most Dangerous Podcast. That's what we name this podcast. If anything, just for shock value, to be honest
with you. Trying to get those hits. Oh, well, whatever. It's all good. I know everybody likes the podcast. I like it, too. I love it, actually. So,
but, yeah, we really didn't have a format. Well, we kind of had a format or whatever, but basically we discussed mostly topics centering around our hobbies, which obviously by the name of this podcast is retro video games for the most part. But we'll probably branch out. Lester does the music thing. I like my comic book stuff. I like my energy drinks. I'm just kidding about the energy drinks thing.
We like our coffee.
Oh, we love our McDonald's. Coffee. This is cheers. Cheers. The first podcast of season six. Yeah, I gotta put the
label
logo on there, huh?
Yep.
So yeah, this podcast today we got a lot of topics we're gonna be talking about. Can you see my screen?
From no, there, I by can't. Any chance? No.
I'm gonna send you. Well, we should look. You have to watch something. So, like I said, no segments, just topics that we're talking about.
Okay.
Can you see it okay?
Yeah. Oh, I thought you were going to just tell me what it is and then...
No, there's something discuss. I want you to watch. The first segment of our video,
okay,
of our podcast is Thrift Dweller Reacts.
Okay.
So, hold on, I got to pull up the video.
Am I going to react to these?
Or we're both. I didn't actually watch it, but I know what the topic's about. A boot. That's how Canadians say about, by the way.
Why is there a picture of me on your computer?
They use it for editing purposes.
It's funny, we have a personal chat. It's just us three. And like we send each other memes to each other. Of us. It's pretty funny.
Of memes.
They're not appropriate, but...
Sorry, yeah. If you're watching the uncut edited version of this podcast, I tend to speak a lot. And one of the things I'm trying to maintain this year is a nice regular delivery, you know. But like they said, the best wrestlers are the ones who are themselves cranked to 11.
Exactly.
I'm crazy. I think I have some.
I've been liking who I've been watching, The Miz, man.
Miz is good, eh?
Yeah, Miz is really good.
Miz is pushing like main event status again. I'm not like pushed artificially.
No,
like, he's earning his way up there. Yeah, we'll talk about wrestling. If you guys want to follow us on WrestleMania Day, Thrift Dweller is going to be hosting a party, live streaming on Twitch or YouTube, whatever.
Sable's going to be here.
That's what we call Gary. Okay, Lester, you ready for this?
Mm.
Which one of us at Thrift Dweller requested this video? Let me know. Hopefully there's no feedback. You can already tell who this video is by.
What the heck?
What? They got that grunt?
No way they're making a movie like this.
It's quiet. Charles Dia, I guess, is Solid Snake. It's a ridiculous cardboard box. She's a snake eater, Lester. The Phantom Peen. Metal Rear Solid. A Triple X parody. That's pretty funny.
Is this real? 8/2/2017.
That's
so
August 2nd.
August.
Oh my god. Did you see the goat?
Yeah.
Being evacuated or whatever?
And they're really gonna do that?
That's funny. There's a parody. It's kind of funny, on what? Actually.
Pornhub? Like,
it's how do you pronounce that? Browsers?
I don't know.
People who watch that kind of thing, let me know.
What the heck?
Which one of us asked for that?
Not me.
Probably me. Because my favorite game of 2015 was Metal Gear Solid, right? 5, Phantom Pain?
I'm not surprised, but at the same time, it's like, really?
Come what are your on, thoughts? Man. Is that all you have to say? Your initial reaction is like, come on.
And
I think it's hilarious.
They should make Devil May Scream or something.
I thought... to me, you can tell the people who produce this quality video don't really have any love for the source material, in my opinion.
No, they don't. No,
there's like, so much they could do with it.
They're probably like in EB. They're looking at video game covers. Oh, let's make a porno out of this, man.
Who's the one guy?
I forget Otacon.
Otacon?
He has shy, like, nerdy Asian fetish? Dude,
yeah. Otacon wasn't actually in Phantom Pain. It was his dad, I believe. I remember. It's been so long since I played Metal Gear. So let me know in the comments below, people who are big fans of Metal Gear Solid 5 or just Metal Gear Solid fans in general. What is your reaction? Is this the first time you've seen this trailer for this quality movie? I think I saw this on IGN, to be honest with you.
I'm surprised they didn't have, like, John Cena or something, or Randy Orton.
Funny you mentioned wrestling. There is a new... I saw it on WrestleTalk.com, I believe. There's a new quality video. That's what we're going to name them in this podcast. Porno videos are being known as quality videos. There's a new one based off of wrestling. It's a parody off the Montreal Screwjob.
Oh, is that when they're in the ring? I think I saw that.
I don't know. I just saw pictures of it.
I don't watch that stuff, but, like, you know, obviously on the internet, news it's gets funny. Around. So it's just
so
like...
So I've heard from people on the internet in private browsers. Because you've had...
Imagine when they do that, you know, when Bret Hart spit onto Vince, they'll have it in the thing.
No, I always imagine. Because it's gender bending, right?
Yeah.
So Vince McMahon is like the male porn star.
Yeah.
And Shawn Michaels and Bret Hart are replaced by female porn stars. So, like...
What did Bret do after? God. Go backstage, right? Oh.
Because as we all know, right? We grew up with the Montreal Screwjob. Yeah. Basically, if you don't know what it is, Bret Hart had creative control of his contract before he went to WCW. And he didn't want to drop the belt to Shawn Michaels on a Survivor Series, right?
Mm-hmm.
So, Vince McMahon screwed him by changing the finish. If you didn't know, wrestling's fake. Change the finish of that match.
Yeah.
And so he came out and he's like, ring the bell. And Bret Hart loses the title when Shawn Michaels is putting him in a sharpshooter. And the story goes is that Bret Hart was tapping out, which obviously they couldn't kayfabe that.
Yeah. Vince didn't screw Bret. Bret screwed Bret.
You know, and it started this whole thing. For years, he was bitter about it. And I think Bret Hart came out the one looking the most bitter out of that over the years, you know?
Yeah.
Like a grumpy old man. And it's really sad what happened to Bret. He had a stroke, and he's like one of the best wrestlers of all time. Yeah,
Goldberg ruined his career, too. Man.
He says Goldberg's super kick is what led... It's his first concussion he's ever gotten, he said. And it led to his stroke, probably. Allegedly, according to Bret Hart. But, man, I think... You know what? If he didn't have that stroke, he could have still been doing like the Ric Flair thing. And oh, Bret Hart was a...
He could have been, you know, if he didn't have a stroke and stuff, you know, he could have been... you know, general manager on Raw or SmackDown. That'd been cool.
He was never, like, known for his mic skills, eh?
Still.
He was given material by, like, Vince. You know, his best lines are obviously scripted for him. He even admitted when he first started, his promo work was bad. He was that guy that was always like, I'll see you on Monday.
Yeah.
The best there is, the best, you know, catchphrases. And he wasn't great off the cuff and stuff.
I'm not really too happy right now. But it was weird seeing Bret in WCW. But anyway, yeah.
He didn't do well there. But we deviated. No. Our main topic was this Metal Gear Solid porno video trailer.
What
that
the hell
out.
Is that about?
Anyway. I thought that was hilarious. You didn't think that was funny? You weren't as big a fan of it as I.
I didn't
did
like
you finish
five.
The game?
No.
Why did
I
you
was
like
halfway
five?
Through and I was like, eh. Quiet, you know what? I didn't even finish four either. I finished the first three. But that was a long time ago. So there was that weird gap between...
Maybe that's the reason. Because I loved 5.
Yeah. There was a weird gap. I'll give it a chance again. I don't know. But
it's a long game, you know, and it's broken up differently. Like, it's an open world.
Oh, yeah. That's
game.
Why I said, like, 2 years ago. I didn't like how it was, like, all TV style. You finish a mission, goes to credits. Then you go to another one, goes to credits. Anyway.
Do you think there's going to be more video game portals to come?
There's lots. Search it. There's probably one on Tomb Raider. There's one on...
I haven't seen any, Lester.
Yeah,
this is the first mainstream one I've seen. I know they've done, like, a Star Trek one, because it's on the Star Trek forums I go to.
Yeah, that's gross.
Let me know in the comments below what Video games should be next for Brazzers.
Smash Brothers.
That's like a furry video.
Super Smash Brothers.
Okay, moving on to our next topic, titled Bad Fur Day. As you may know, Lester, I'm a part of many forums on the internet and such.
Yeah, you join those ones.
I join a lot on Facebook, Atari Age, Nintendo Age. I'm on a lot of forums, let's say. And I'm not going to name the specific forums when I bring up topics from those forums because it's kind of like a close-knit community. But I will protect the identities of people in those ones. And I won't mention the forum. But I will bring topics that are inspired by those forums, okay? Okay. Bad Fur Day.
The game?
This is the N64? This is the story.
Oh, okay.
Okay. There's a gentleman who's like, this is the comment he put. He's been looking for Bad Fur Day, I guess, complete in box for 6 years. Mm-hmm. He's been retro gaming for 6 years, and he finally came across it online.
Oh, and he was wondering why it was like
$300 or whatever? No, listen, well, who cares about the price? He bought it,
yeah,
obviously online, because he didn't find it in the wild, he said. And he got it home for a week. And then he posts this picture. See if I can find that picture. Can you see this picture, Lester?
Oh, is there nothing in it?
His dog
chewed
up half the box of his Conker. If you don't know Conker's Bad Fur Day, it's a very expensive game right now in the retro video game community. And you can see here, it says dog shaming at its finest. He's very lucky the girlfriend got to him before I did. He won't dare even look at me. Look at the picture. The dog's scared of his owner because he chewed up the box. First thing I have to say is, kudos to that fucking dog.
Yeah, exactly.
I hate that game so much.
Yeah.
Whose fault is that, Lester? The dog or the owners? Owner. Why?
Because he just left the game like that. But you can't blame an animal because obviously, you know, an animal doesn't know better sometimes.
But look at that box. It's half chewed up. And the dog is so shit. I'm like, kudos. Somebody made a picture of the dog. Like, they made a meme. And they put the Thug Life glasses on.
Oh, really?
Like, good for you.
I can't blame an animal, man. Like,
it's not,
I've
you
had,
know what? I'm a dog owner.
I had cats in my life. Yeah, they've wrecked stuff. But at the same time, like, as an owner, you should know what your dog or whatever you have is capable of.
Because I remember, there was a guy, a dog trainer on the TV I was watching. I think it was Caesar.
Yeah.
He says, if your dog pees in the house, you roll up a newspaper
and
then hit yourself in the head with it.
Yeah.
Because you should not have left the dog in a position to pee in the house. That was absolutely the owner's fault, in my opinion. But what really shocked me in this story here, there's some comments that people left.
Yeah.
And like half the people wanted to like...
kill the dog?
Yeah.
Why? Hey, the game still works.
The game's a game. Like, the game is still loose. Half-eaten box. Personally, it's the owner's fault. Yeah. A, he should have put the game on a higher shelf or something.
Exactly.
I don't know. You spent 6 years looking for this game. You're going to leave it on the floor.
Yeah.
You might as well have left it on the floor if the dog was able to get to it. B, we talked about it before, and this actually inspired a new segment in this podcast. Remember how you said we wanted to talk about more, not just like, this is my shelf, but how do you preserve the game? How are you saving the game? Like, how do you archive this game properly, right?
Yeah.
So, he could have put a box protector.
A box protector.
How much could have that protected this game, you know?
Yeah, it probably had, like, a dent or two, but not ripped.
You can't even salvage that box. To the guy who owns that box, please send me that box. I'll pay for the shipping.
We'll
pay
glue
for
it
a
back
box.
Together.
No, I'm going to frame it and say, you know, well-deserved or some shit like that. That game is so, like... You know what really drove the price up of that game was, eh? It's this bandwagon newbie market, I think. Why is that game so expensive? Let me know in the comments below. Obviously, people are going to say, because of the demand for it. Because
it's a game made by Rare and it has swears in it. Like, who cares?
Is that the criteria for a Rare expensive game
in
today's market?
I don't know. I'm going to admit, though, when that came out, I had a PlayStation. But obviously, the people we grew up with had N64 as well. But you didn't really hear that from our circles. Like, they would say, oh, play Bad Fur Day. Now it was more like, oh, why don't we play WCW?
Yeah.
Or something.
Bad Fur Day is one of those games that I don't understand.
Yeah.
Like, I've played it, and I'm like, this is nothing special.
Yeah, exactly.
You know? I guess people want it for their completionist or whatever. Yeah. But there were a lot of people that commented on this, like, oh, that dog, if that was my dog, he'd be having more than a Bad Fur Day. You know, all these people who are, like, threatening. There are people, like, threatening to harm the dog. And that's one of the, I don't get triggered, right?
Yeah.
Animal rights is my trigger.
And I've never hit an animal either. I'd be like, man, what the hell?
So, I have some comments here. I'll read out two of them that are commending the dog. Because these two are like overshadowed by everyone else who hated the dog. Like, this is the owner's fault. You should get mad at the owner. Anyways, this guy says, where do you see a quality box game? All I see, there's shit N64 game. Doggo should be commended for his deed. Absolutely there. Good dog. Game's overrated.
Yeah, exactly.
This one guy's like, you mean overpriced, not overrated. I'm like, that's smart, eh? I've never heard of any praise of this game being the best, just being expensive.
Yeah.
And the guy's like, my apologies, both. Another segment that's going to be inspired by this one specific story, the bandwagon trail. Talk about, like, here, I'll show a meme of it here on the screen. Bandwagoners. Do you believe there are bandwagoners in terms of retro video game collecting?
Yes.
Here's the meme. Bandwagon retro gamer starter kit. A retro gamer t-shirt, so corny. Earthbound, the Game Chasers, is obviously... Because they're very commercial, I guess. Yeah. You know, and it's trying to appeal to a mainstream market.
I really don't care anymore. I've never, like...
Don't explain yourself, yeah. Lester.
I don't watch it. Like, it doesn't appeal to me. Like, you know, I saw a couple episodes. Like, cool, I get what they do, but me personally, eh.
It's not your cup of tea.
No, exactly. I'd rather watch, you know, Casey the Game Nerd or something, or...
Homie! Click!
CJR, right?
I like CJR, actually. Yeah. You know, he's that Canadian charm.
Mm-hmm.
Little Samson on this meme, I will disagree with. Not because, you know, I think it is very expensive, that game, and people pay a pretty penny for it, but it's actually a really good game. Little Samson, you ever play it?
I've never played it.
It's like Mega Man clone with different powers, and you can switch in different stages and such. It's a really good game. I don't think it's worth the $900 price tag, but if I saw it, I would buy it.
Yeah.
This game, when I first started retro collecting, was in the 300s. Not even. And that was pretty high for me back then, right?
Yeah.
And this was... I was already maybe 4 years into collecting, and the internet started getting very popular. Ooh, Little Samson's $300. $900 of people are asking for the game. Loose. Locally, some guy put a $1,000 price tag on this game. Like, can you...
And we don't know if it's real or fake. Could be a repro. My God.
People are getting really smart. That's why I don't even bother with, like, those games anymore. I'm so afraid of getting, like, a fake game. Reproductions that aren't labels as such should be burnt. That's just my opinion. Anyways, final thoughts on the dog. Good for you.
Good for the dog. Don't hit your animal, man. Like, okay, this guy who, like, got really mad at his dog, what if their house burns and the guy faints? The dog's not going to save him because the dog's going to remember, oh, this guy was mean to me. I'll just leave him burning in the house.
This is a really a troll-heavy page.
Yeah.
So he could have been just joking around.
Yeah.
Or, you know, we don't know the circumstances. Maybe he didn't get mad at his dog. But, like, if that happened to me and my dog ate my game, I'd be like, fuck me.
Yeah, exactly.
You know? My fault for that. But like I said, new segment on the Retro Gaming's Most Dangerous podcast. Archiving. We're going to talk about ways people are archiving games. ROM dumping really rare cartridges. That's a new story from Pat the NES Punk.
Yeah. I haven't seen the game, but the people are doing the projects of re-dumping all these ROMs or all these games back into ROM form because they've been dumped the wrong way back in the 90s. So now they want to do it correctly.
Plus finding games that are super rare.
Yeah.
And like the basic premise is if you don't dump these games, something happens to like the only cartridge in existence.
Yeah.
The game is lost forever. Right?
And I showed Nathaniel, a documentary. It was like a 30-minute one from Japan, and this group of Japanese, or actually the guy's French, but he lives in Japan, he's a teacher there or whatever he does, but they archive, and that's what they do on their spare time after their real life jobs. They archive everything: arcade games, console games, old cassette games that like don't exist anymore.
No, these guys definitely do the work for us, and like click on the link below. I'll have a link to that video that you're talking about, okay? All right, yeah, archiving. So let's talk about, in our podcast, every time we do it, a different aspect of archiving, you know. I chose the easiest thing for the first one, but like I want to showcase people in the community that are like doing this, like the heroes of archiving.
Mm-hmm.
But I got to do my research before I do that. But like, universal game cases, very controversial. Some people hate them, some people...
Yeah.
Love them, don't mind them.
Keep the dust out.
But basically what they are, they're like, if you ever get if you ever went into a rental store back in the day and you rented a game, it came in like this clear slipcover polyurethane case or whatever. It's a protective case. It's like a reproduction case. Mm-hmm. And people have gotten really fancy. You can go online, thecoverproject.net. You could print covers that are specially made for these reproduction universal game cases. We'll just call them UGCs for now. Benefits, they protect the game. Keep the dust out, right? Like you said, they look nice on the shelf. They're pretty fancy.
Yeah.
And there's like a whole community of people making just custom covers and stuff. Really nice, actually. Yeah. And if you have a manual, you kind of have somewhere to put the manual now.
Yeah, you can slip it in.
Yeah. Drawbacks, obviously, the space, right?
Space.
Is it real collecting? You know, the real, putting the cartridge on the shelf, that's the original state of that cartridge, right? But you are leaving it unprotected on the shelf. But, you know, there's a sense of keeping it real.
Yeah.
Is Universal Game Cases, UGCs, keeping it real? It's almost like...
It puts it in your library, man. Cause
but you're trying to make it look fancy. It looks nice. Shit. I don't know.
The thing is, too, right, theft. Some guy, you know, you have it all nice and fancy. Somebody could steal that game, and you might not know because you think it's safe. Right?
Maybe.
You come back to it like a month later. Oh, man.
I only let friends in my house, bro.
That's true.
So I'll know you stole it.
Yeah, like you look and it's like gone. But I don't know. I'm big on protection.
Yeah, so you...
Yeah, I'd do it. But at the same time, it's...
The pricing, too, of this thing is expensive.
Yeah,
I was going to say...
$1.20?
Well, to get it to you...
If you don't get it bulk?
Yeah, it's like... By the time you pay shipping... And the actual price of it, it's about $1 a piece plus shipping, $1.50, $2. If you buy like packages of 100, I know people on eBay, the entrepreneurs on eBay are trying to sell them for like $5 a case if you buy one. Yeah, there's some really crazy markups there. Plus, I don't even know the acidity of these things. If you're a comic book collector, you buy the gold standard bags for your comics, bag and boards, that are advertised acid-free, right? Because you don't want acid touching.
Yeah,
your comic books, because that prematurely wears the comics, and you're supposed to change your plastics every 7 years, basically.
Oh, really?
I'm not even joking. Yeah, okay. I have comics over here. I know. Look at my comics. I know what I'm doing.
I have plastic covers for my CDs, the ones that have like paper.
Yeah.
Paper packaging.
How do you feel about that?
Oh, it feels good, man. It's nice.
Because basically,
take it out like, oh, man.
All plastic has an acidity to it. Sometimes they're just low acidity, so like it's not gonna affect it if you change it regularly, right?
Oh, I didn't know that 7-year rule.
For comic books.
Yeah.
Yeah. They recommend it. Obviously, they probably say that because they want you to buy more of their product. You know what I mean? And sometimes they don't fit games properly. Like, the majority of the ones that are out there don't fit Nintendo cartridges. You have to modify it to fit Nintendo cartridges. Just saying. There are some variants of these UGCs. The main one I've seen is the one from Stone Age Gaming. Gamers. It's like the plastic one. It's like they made it themselves. It's like a vacuum-formed plastic.
Yeah.
I think those are kind of big and bulky. I'm not too happy about those ones.
Me personally?
What do you think about UGCs personally?
I'm a fan only if, you know, you want to keep the label in pristine shape. But otherwise, I'm old school. Like, I really loved the dust covers that Super Nintendo and Nintendo games came with.
Is that all you need?
I think so.
I think so, too. But yeah, you don't protect the label.
No.
You know what term really bugs me? And it started when this whole market came into place. The label is minty. I hate that minty.
It's still shiny. I still call it shiny.
Oh, God.
I try to smell it, too.
That's when you knew the comic book people were coming into our industry.
Yeah.
That and the gaming, the grading thing that vacuum seals your game or whatever.
UGCs, though, like, it's good for small collections, like Jason's or Zangief's, Canadian Zangief's. Like, you go down his basement, his corner, all his stuff's, like, in UGCs, and it's all the games he likes. And it looks good, because it doesn't take up a lot of space, right?
It's clean, man.
It's clean, but if you have something like a whole wall like Nathaniel, if he ended up putting all these in UGCs, it would probably take the whole room
250 again. Nintendo games on a shelf isn't too bad.
And it would feel like a video store.
In Universal Game Cases, that's double the size it takes. And some people like that store look, right? I personally might. If I thin my collection out, which I do plan on doing.
Yeah, if it takes the whole wall, whatever. Yeah. But if it's to the point where it's like, okay, go in this section and it feels like a library. No.
Would you recommend Universal Game Cases out there for the general public? I guess you already
If you said. Have like 10 games you really, really, really want to put them in, yeah, sure. But if it's to the point of putting your whole library in a game case, no. I'm old school, man. Like, again, put your Nintendo games in a box. Put it somewhere. Take it out. have the dust covers. To me, that feels like my childhood. Dust covers and a Nintendo game.
Yeah. It's subjective.
Yeah.
It's whatever you want your collection to be. Don't let us, like, tell you what to do. Do what you want, yeah. man. Personally, for me, anytime soon, I'm not buying it.
Yeah.
Because I don't need it.
No.
Most of my games are in DVD cases anyways. I don't mind DVD cases because I hate loose discs, basically.
Yeah.
And you need a case for disc-based games. Cartridges, they're built like tanks, basically. They still survive to this day. So, obviously, you know, they're durable. Let's just say they're durable. Moving on to our next topic. All right. Not live action. It's Netflix. Netflix revealed earlier this year that later in 2017, they're going to be releasing a Castlevania episodic series that you can watch. It'll be released at the, I think part one of season one will be out at the end of, or near the last half of 2017. It will consist of 4 30-minute episodes. And there's been some updates, actually, since I've written this thing. But basically, the Adi Shankar, I guess, he's one of the producers on the show, or mm-hmm. the producer of the show. He answered a few questions about it in an interview. I think IGN is the one I got the source of this from. But basically, people are concerned about, like, oh, you know, is this going to be like a PG-13 version, blah, blah, blah. He actually released a picture of the poster. He released a picture of the show poster. And I'll show it to Lester here real quickly. I'll show it to you guys too on camera. What do you think about the poster? The star is the castle. It doesn't reveal much. You got the moon in the back. And
looks like a cover of Symphony of the Night. Yeah. Open. Go search. Google search a cover of Symphony of the Night.
Yeah, it's just a purple and black version as compared to this. I like the poster. You got the blood moon in the back, right? You got Castlevania. For people who don't know Castlevania, the mythos goes that I don't know how often it comes back. Not every generation, but Castlevania is like a living entity in itself.
Something, yeah.
And basically, it signals the return of Dracula. IGN had a chance to speak with Adi Shankar about the show. And he said the storyline, which we didn't know initially, this one is going to be based off of Castlevania 3 Dracula's Curse.
Oh!
Yeah, and it features the last surviving member of the disgraced Belmont clan trying to save Eastern Europe from extinction at the hand of Vlad Dracula. Castlevania 3 is probably my favorite Castlevania.
That's a good one. Yeah, I loved it.
So kudos to them for picking Castlevania 3. There's also like sub-characters in the game you could pick.
Yeah.
So, you know, that might be nice for a bigger cast of characters. We'll see. I don't know. But he did say this game will be done, or this, sorry. He movie did say the Netflix show will be done in the vein of Game of Thrones, and it'll be R-rated as fuck. Good. That was my biggest concern, right? They said it was going to be... At first they said it was going to be, like, not a parody, but, like, a satire of Castlevania. Yeah. That kind of scared me a little bit.
I can't... But now have someone, like for TV shows, someone dictate my imagination from what I thought with Castlevania. You know what I mean? You grow up with Castlevania. So you're already being
a doubter of
this. I'm not being a doubter. It's more of like, I'll probably skip it.
And well, you're not even going to give it a chance?
I'd watch it or whatever, but you know what I mean? Like, your imagination from back then, like your interpretation of Castlevania is different from what a director can show, right?
So it's like when people made, let's say,
Street Fighter,
the Da Vinci Code.
I never read the books.
I know, but then the people who did read the book were very disappointed.
Yeah, they were.
In the movie,
yeah.
Because it's one man's envisioning of the Da Vinci Code, and there's like a million different people's interpretation of that book.
Right? Exactly.
So people hated it. I liked it because I never read the book. So yeah, I guess kudos to me. I didn't follow Castlevania's storyline that much, so I probably won't be disappointed. I'm looking forward to it.
If it's going to be super violent, cool. I love super violent stuff, but...
like Old Boy and stuff, right?
Yeah. But you can't... I don't know, man. We'll see how the interpretation goes. If it's, you know, dark and gloomy and stuff, it'd be cool. I'd be okay with it. But I just... there's a lot of video game stuff that I cannot get into once it's interpreted into different format. You know what I mean? Like,
do you think do you think it not being live action, it being... cartoon animated You don't like that?
No.
Why not?
Oh, man, because it's stupid. There's a lot of cartoons, too, man. Like, did you watch the Mega Man one? Me and Ian were watching that one. It was stupid.
But that's the subject matter of that is very child-oriented.
Yeah. If they made a cartoon, I don't know how I'd feel about it, too. I don't know, man.
I don't know.
When I think of some of these franchises that were video games, I cannot see it as other forms of entertainment. So it's hard for me.
You think they should make an 8-bit movie of Castlevania 3?
Sure.
Somebody actually
with like voice acting, right? Like, oh.
Well, somebody commented, not even voice acting, just text boxes every like 5-10
seconds.
Yeah, I'll
read it. That's cool.
That's why you are not a producer of a show, my friend. I think the animated thing is good considering the alternative. If you've ever seen like, let's say, they have some live action vampire zombie shows on Netflix. I can't think of anything. Van Helsing they have.
Mm-hmm.
That looks horrible. Yeah. I can tell it's like Canadian bad CGI. So if they did Castlevania, which is very imaginative, and it would obviously be super CGI heavy, I think it would make it look corny. And if they actually animated this in the style of, per se, Attack on Titan or like the really gory animes, I think it might be pretty, compared to like live action. Obviously, I would love live action, but it would have to be like Lord of the Rings quality live action.
Yeah.
You know, like that high production. I don't think Netflix has that. So animated, I think, is the probably the best go-to choice in terms of, like, you can do lots of gore, lots of blood, especially if you've seen, if you watch a lot of anime, they go pretty crazy over there in Japan.
They do.
With that anime style. If it's animated in the style of, like, Samurai Jack or whatever, like, it looks like a Flash cartoon. You remember Flash guys on the internet? Oh, I hated those cartoons. Like, Powerpuff Girls? It's like the whole screen's moving, but it's like this. Yeah. I know, but you know what I'm saying, right? That shitty animation that's obviously really cheap. I think that's going to be a sign of failure. That'll turn me off immediately.
Yeah. I don't know.
But if they do it better, if they do it well, I think it has a chance for success, in my opinion. You know, it being animated, I think, does limit it, though, in terms of, like, the mainstream audience. Not everyone's going to watch it. Like, live action, obviously, more people will want to watch it because it'll remind them of, like, I don't know, The Walking Dead or something.
Maybe they shouldn't have named it Castlevania and named it something else. I don't know.
That's horrible, Lester. That's why you don't make shows,
yeah,
sir.
That's why... Castlevania, the show.
What? In terms of... Okay, let's say Konami...
Like, I'm...
Okay, go ahead.
Contra, the show.
Lester does not... Lester's barred from making shows, everyone.
You're cool, man.
Okay, okay, Konami. We all know Konami has kind of made some, in terms of the gamer community, poor choices that we don't want to support them on. They let Hideo Kojima leave. They've said they're going to focus less on console gaming and more on, like, mobile indie game, or not indie, but mobile gaming per se. Does this show something? Like, maybe they're trying to, because Konami has such a back catalog of really successful titles. Castlevania, isn't there? A Jackal, I guess you could say Jackal. What else is a Konami game?
Contra, Metal Gear.
They have a back catalog of such successful video game franchises, and I think if they went the mobile route, they'd bastardize it all.
Like, I think
Mega
so.
Man Mobile. Don't get me on that. But I don't know. Do you think if Konami sees, hey, Castlevania, because they haven't done anything good with Castlevania in a long time. If this show is successful, do you think it would prompt them to do something else with Castlevania series in terms of, like, the old school Castlevania? Or do you think they're just so stupid they'll just continue going where they're going?
Let's just do another show.
The Contra show, right?
Metal Gear would be a crazy...
Yeah, what?
How many seasons would that be? But then it would be weird.
That would be very difficult because of Kojima. He would have to be the producer of that. But it would make his dream come true of, like, producing a Hollywood type thing.
Yeah.
You know, he always wanted to do... You know, he wanted to be a director, right? Like, he puts big stars in his games and such. Kiefer Sutherland in the last Metal Gear game. But hopefully it's good. Let me know in the comments below what you guys think about the Castlevania animated series. Who's correct here? I think it has a chance for success.
I don't.
Let me know in the comments
only
below.
Last one season, and it's just gonna be.
It's already slated for two, Lester.
Oh, it's gonna be in the dumpster of Netflix.
In the rabbit holes.
When you click on the show, it just says season one. Where's the rest of it? Oh, they canceled.
Canceled it. they already funded it, and they still canceled it. Oh my God! Moving on. Now that Lester has his haterade on.
People, I just don't like the idea, man.
We don't push hate on here. Okay, that's it. We're done.
Yeah.
It's over. We don't push hate on this channel, okay? We like to discuss topics in a somewhat intelligent manner. Of course, sometimes we do a little bit of trolling, more for fun type thing. We don't troll on, you know, to hate people. We don't make fun of people, you know, with disabilities and such. That's just in poor taste, let's say. But if you are in the retro video game community, like I am in the forums and in the groups online, there's some very strong opinions about certain, let's say, retro gaming celebrities or celebrities. Okay, there are some people that people love. For instance, AVGN, Angry Video Game Nerd. I would say that almost the majority consensus is that they love him, right?
Yeah.
People adorn him. AVGN's like the god of retro video game YouTube content. Everyone else to me is below him. That's just my personal opinion. People have very strong opinions about those people below AVGN. For instance, the person we're going to discuss today is the author of the NES Essential Guide book. Mm-hmm. He is also the host of the Completely Unnecessary podcast. People know him as Pat the NES Punk. And full disclosure, I follow his podcast more than anything. I've been watching him for years.
Yeah.
I don't hate the guy. Like, I'm not going to say I'm a super fan of him.
Yeah.
I respect what he does. I think he hustles hard. And for the most part, I think his opinions, I share the majority of his opinions. But if he has an opinion I don't share, I don't hate him for it.
Right? Exactly. It's like, speak your mind, man.
But
and I think that's why people don't like him.
There's a group I've joined. I'm going to say they're pretty troll heavy, let's say. They don't troll on like Angry Video Game Nerd, but they do seem to troll on a certain section of people.
Yeah.
And we're going to discuss those people throughout these podcast series as we go. But today we're focusing on Pat the NES Punk. So I put a post. I was like, hey, why do people hate Pat the NES Punk? Probably like the most popular post for that week. I think it went close to 100 like responses.
Oh, really?
There was a lot of people that were like, man, majority of the people were not fans of him on this particular site, right?
That's weird.
Pat the NES Punk has over 250,000 like followers on YouTube. He's pretty popular, I'll say. He has an extensive video game collection. But half the people don't like him, I guess. Let's say he's controversial, like John Cena. I've been told him.
Really?
He's like John Cena, right? He's like the face that runs the place, one of the faces. And he's been around for so long, he's like a staple of the retro video game community on YouTube, but not everyone likes him. He's like Roman Reigns of the YouTube retro video game community. Some people have strong dislike for him, let's say. There's a lot of comments on the post I made. There's a lot of people who commented. I'm not going to say the ones that were mean.
Yeah.
And the ones that were like obviously not trying to answer the question of why is Pat the NES Punk unpopular to certain people. There are some people who did try to answer it intelligently.
Yeah, that's good.
And those are the people we will focus on today. But let's just say there was a lot of really mean trolls out there. Lester, I'll show you some of the mean troll comments, but I'm not going to share them on this podcast because I don't condone it. But they are pretty funny trolls. Sometimes I think these people troll
just because.
And it's funny, right? You know what I mean? If people trolled on us, Lester, how would you feel?
Oh, man, I'd laugh.
We don't take ourselves
Honestly, we don't care. We actually look for it.
Oh, look at this one. Because it's kind of funny, to be honest. People like to take Pat's face and put them on, like, movie and video game and music covers.
Yeah.
And I don't know what spawned this, but you like this one?
Yeah, that's funny.
Pat the NES Punk as Michael Jackson's bad? Like, if someone did that for Lester's face or my face, I don't think we'd be offended.
I don't care.
Where's another one?
Because people wonder, who is this guy? And then they'll find thrift store. Oh, okay, cool.
Look at this one. It's Pat as Bob Ross painting himself with the NES minis all over his female gender-bent body. I think that's pretty funny. That's a good meme right there. You know, he should be like, hey, he's an artist. Yeah. Like Bob Ross. Bob Ross is like a magician on the freaking canvas. This one I will not share. But let's see. This guy basically... Pat the NES Punk spent a lot of time making this book. He kickstarted it successfully, The Ultimate Nintendo Guide. This one guy, which is really mean, because the book is like $60, right? Online, which is not bad. It's a high-quality hardcover book. This guy is like literally sharing a link how to download illegally, mind you, the book for free in PDF format. So there's some people that don't like Pat the NES Punk. And those people... Who are not intelligently arguing this, I'm not going to
It's more advertising for him, really.
This one is funny.
The cover of Boston and Hall & Oates.
Of course he's not Daryl Hall.
Yeah.
He's John Oates. That's pretty funny, though. But I don't know if Pat would care too much about like those.
It's advertising.
But you know that saying Like, they'd rather be them talking bad about you than not talking about you
at all. Right? Yeah.
You know what I mean? One of the reasons this one person says people don't like Pat the NES Punk is the majority of people in the retro video gaming community don't like people. They'll have a strong distaste for them because they're trying to be famous for not doing anything but having a big collection. You know what I'm trying to say?
Oh.
Like, look how big my collection is. I want to be famous now.
Yeah.
He's not, like, talented in any way. He's not... you know, he has nothing special about him except for the fact he got into the retro video game market early and got a bunch of games for cheap.
Hey, kudos.
Do you agree with that? Do you hate on people? Not Pat per se, but just like people who try to be famous for having nothing special about them.
Do what you want to do, man. I think, people are just jealous of what he has. Like, I don't know how he's like in real life.
You think
life.
It's a haterade?
I think so.
People are drinking the haterade because he has a big collection and people are like, I wish I had that collection.
Yeah, exactly. Like,
I think a lot of it is haterade.
There's people who have like crazier, you know, CD collections than me. I wish I had what they have, but no, like, I'm being a realist. No, I can't. You know what I mean?
Do you hate them?
No, I don't hate. Well, you get jealous, but it's not to the point where I'm like making memes of these dudes.
I think the funny memes are funny.
Trolling them.
The mean memes I don't like.
But too much. Man, I'm not going to go out of my way and tell someone or let it be known that I hate this guy because he has like every Nintendo game. Like, I got every Nintendo game too on my laptop, but you know what I mean?
Like, I think the fact that these forums are almost like they're a closed community.
Yeah.
So it kind of stays within the community. That's why I'm not exposing the names of these groups that I'm talking about here. So they feel like comfortable doing it.
Yeah, exactly.
Do you think we will, because we're doing this podcast and such, are going to be like the subject of many
threads? Oh, I don't care.
Threads?
Do whatever you want. I really don't care. Talk about us.
I don't mind.
People get the wonder.
Personally, I think Pat, like, his comedy sometimes is funny. It's not always funny to me. That's just being real. I don't
laugh at his jokes, but I'll watch his content.
It's kind of true, actually.
The only reason why I watch him, to be honest with you, is because it pops up on my YouTube feed, and that's the only time I'll watch him. Otherwise, I won't go out of my way to watch it. But, you know, if there's, like, a subject that he's going to talk about, you know, I'll see it if I have time.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Well, I think people just... Another guy on one of the responses to my question on the forum I'm talking about said that people with very strong opinions, and Pat does have some really strong opinions, if they don't agree with their opinion, they hate you automatically.
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
Like,
I agree with most of Pat's opinions, to be honest. I think he represents the retro video game community, you know, in terms of, like, the collective voice.
Yeah.
Not stupidly, you know? He's pretty cogent in his arguments. I think he hustles hard, too. Like, he does a lot of podcasts. He works hard to put out content. He just doesn't do content like us, right? He writes his content, and he has guest stars on his content and such. So I think he hustles hard, and I respect the hustle. Like, John Cena. I don't hate John Cena because I respect his hustle. But yeah, I think people don't like Pat sometimes because he keeps it real, and he doesn't sugarcoat his...
Yeah, exactly.
His opinions. I just think also the bigger you get, just inevitable people will not. You'll get a following of people that don't like you per se. It's very hard to be like universally accepted.
Yeah.
Like, even The Rock has a group of people that hate him. And the majority of people love I love The Rock.
I love him too.
You know, we grew up with The Rock, man. He's my idol. My 4 o'clock a.m. motivation. Yeah. He's on Twitter posting, already did 3 miles. What you doing?
Like, 8 pizzas already. Like, oh, wow, Rock.
That's cheat day, bro.
I wish I could be like you, man. I'm on a helicopter to film my show.
Oh, The Rock is on Gains like O'Clock.
4 hours later, oh, I'm in the gym. Like, wow.
I know, but that's his job. Right? Yeah. My job is to be swole all day, too. Like,
wow, you have a life, Rock. Me.
Oh, well, the funny part...
I came back from work. I'm at home playing
I'm
video
tired,
games.
Bro. I'm tired, bro. There's one skit The Rock did. It was really funny to me. He's in front of, like, a big horse or whatever. Yeah. Some monument. And he's like, this is The Rock. 50% black, 50% Samoan, 50% Clydesdale. I was like, yeah. The Rock's the man. He crushes everybody. But he hustles hard. So
he does.
Respect
yeah,
him, right?
Exactly.
Why don't people respect Pat the NES Punk? Because he's not swole? I don't know. But basically, I asked him about it, Pat the NES Punk. I had a sit-down interview with him on Twitter. I was sitting down when I tweeted him. And I asked him about being controversial and what he thinks about it, right? And he actually responded to me, which was really cool. Basically, he said... Let me get those quotes here. What did he say? Basically, he said that it is not his job to please people.
Exactly.
Nor does he want to please people. He's just him. And I asked him, what do you feel about being like the John Cena of the retro video game community? And he goes, I wish I had his abs... So to me, like, he doesn't, you know, he takes it with a grain of salt. He doesn't take himself too seriously. He calls himself the Pat the NES Punk. Like, come on. You know, I don't think he takes himself too seriously. His friend Ian, who he hosts the Completely Unnecessary podcast with, is
I sick. Like that.
I like Ian, actually.
Yeah.
He's sick, so, you know, well wishes to Ian. People shouldn't be trolling him for being sick. To be
exactly.
Honest. I think that's just bullshit. To troll someone for being sick. You know, he has a GoFundMe if you want to talk, or if you want to hear more about what his condition is, check out the page. And feel free to donate money to him if you like. I donated $5 myself. All right. Is that all the Pat the NES Punk stuff we have to talk about? He responded to me. That's pretty funny.
Ooh.
Woohoo! I gotta put on this the thumbnail for this section of the podcast. We'll have him with like John Cena gear on, I think. Okay, and that's all the topics. This is really just a test of a podcast.
Oh, really?
I can edit it.
I thought there was more.
Is there anything you wanted to talk about?
Not really, no.
Those are pretty
In recent Thrift Dweller news, I've been in contact with Steinbach Steiner. We might be doing something soon. Maybe very soon. Actually, maybe in a month or so. Yeah. I know he's been all up in that.
We recorded our return to YouTube video. Lester wasn't in that one. But check it out. It'll be linked in the description below. We got a lot of videos coming out, actually. We got a good head start because of our winter break, which was nice. We take a break every winter from YouTube just to, you know, refocus, recollect. And coming hard back in season 6. Can you believe the sixth season?
Sixth season, 5 years. Yeah, this is the 5th year. We should draw like a special commemorative poster or something. 5 years.
I am actually working on a commemorative poster for this.
Suits.
But every podcast, I kind of want to end it with like the meme of the day.
Oh, okay.
And this meme is very topical. Oh, look it. We forgot this Pat the NAS Punk
like
meme.
A kiss.
That's a pretty good meme, actually. I would be flattered if someone did that for me. And instead of kiss, it says Ness. That's pretty funny.
I'm saying, if you love what you love to do, man, yeah. Like, anyone who's responding to you, you know you're getting their attention, so.
We're done with that topic, right?
I know.
Okay, there's two memes I wanted to share at the end of this video, because everyone knows I love my memes.
Yeah.
Lester makes memes of me all the time. Maybe I'll share one
that isn't don't.
Inappropriate here. This is one meme, okay? You ever play the game Last of Us?
Yeah. Oh. That's gross, man.
I like the meme. There's the meme of Jim Carrey from, what's it called? Me, Myself, and Irene?
Yeah.
The disgusting face. That's just funny to me. How not to cosplay The Last of Us.
Yeah. Is what this is called. I hope they knew what they were getting themselves into.
I don't know, but I think that's a pretty funny meme.
That's messed up, man.
They're kissing each other? That's so weird.
It's weird, but technically they could.
Well, they're not related. But it's a father-daughter relation. He lost his daughter before the outbreak.
Yeah.
Oh, Ellie. That girl's kind of cute, actually. And this one is topical because Donald Trump. It's the game Super Soccer. And Donald Trump is the goalie, because if you've ever seen the cover of Super Soccer on the Super Nintendo, that guy kind of looks like Donald Trump.
Yeah.
So this guy put a brick wall behind Super Soccer. And you have a Mexican ball trying to get through. And Donald Trump's like, I ain't having that. Stopping that shit. Oh, he's building a wall, guys.
That's funny.
That's the most of our political talks that we will have on this
podcast. Yeah, we probably won't have any.
I don't believe in... Like, there's a time and place for it.
Exactly.
Unless you think it's very important to talk about it, go ahead and talk about it, right? We don't live in the States. It almost feels like I don't have any right...
Yeah, exactly. I can't say anything, per se. Like, I don't know what's going on down there. You know what I mean?
You know, it's like the Philippines right now is having a really big war on drugs, and a lot of people are dying. But Duterte, who's the president of the Philippines, has like a 90-something% approval rating.
Yeah.
By the, I don't live there.
Yeah.
So I'm like, how bad is this drug problem, though? Because to me, I'm like, oh, no one should be murdered or killed, right? Even people who are guilty, you know, maybe these... They're just killing drug dealers left and right. Maybe that guy's trying to feed his family. You know, that always runs through my head.
Yeah. You don't know the circumstances.
How many innocent people are being killed in Crossfire? But I don't know how bad the war on drugs is there. Do I have a right to talk about it?
Yeah.
I'm not there firsthand. So it's just observationally, it's sad for people to be dying like that. It's sad for refugees who are legitimately being driven out of their homes and living in fear to be rejected asylum somewhere else because of fear and such. Stuff like that really does affect me. To be honest, and it's very sad in my opinion, but I don't feel like, unless I'm very well versed in it, I shouldn't be on a platform like YouTube talking.
Exactly. About. Yeah.
You know, I can. If you want to know like my personal opinions, join our Twitter. Check us out on Twitter.
His Twitter. It says Thrift Dollar, but it's.
Well, no one else. Everyone has access to it. All right. You know, one more thing I'll leave you guys with before we go. The new Tomb Raider, Lara Croft, actress, has been released. I didn't really talk about it too much, but let's look at her picture and you can judge. Because if you remember early, was it late 2000s? Early 2000s, they did a Tomb Raider movie.
With Angelina.
Yeah.
Really crappy movies, by the way.
It's the Spike Afternoon special.
Yeah. Oh,
the TBS special. Lara Croft as Tomb Raider. Alicia Vikander is the new face to
play. She looks like her.
Lara Croft. And I personally think she represents the new iteration of Lara Croft very well. Let me know in the comments below, guys, if you think Alicia Vikander will make a good Lara Croft. Obviously, she doesn't have the voluptuousness of... what's her name again?
Angelina Jolie.
Yeah. Because that was the old, like, pin-up version of Lara Croft. And now with the rise of the Tomb Raider and such, she's been more, like, normalized.
Yeah. 1988, hey?
She is a... raised in Gothenburg, Västra Götaland, Sweden. She's Swedish. Actress of stage and screen. Huh. A psychiatrist, too. She's Swedish and one-quarter French descent. Began acting as a child. So I can't really comment on her acting chops. It looks like she's won some awards here. Look at this. She's been in Ex Machina. I didn't know that. She was in Jason Bourne as Heather Lee. She was in The Man from U.N.C.L.E., which I never watched. Anything here that strikes you? She was in a bunch of those. She looks like she's in these movies that are very, like, high-level movies that are, like, below my brow.
Yeah.
You know what I'm trying to say?
It's not, like...
You know, like, dramas and such? Euphoria. She's going to be in the new Tomb Raider coming out 2018. And I think she looks the part. She looks like a very nice lady. Almost too skinny. That's the thing about Hollywood, eh? Everyone looks like they're anorexic or something like that. But you shouldn't judge people on the way they look. Do you think she'll do well? In terms of just the look? You think... You don't like these movie adaptations?
No, man. Like, video games and movies? No. There's a new Resident Evil coming out? No.
Like, it's the final chapter,
yeah,
right?
Like, oh, I don't care. Like,
the final chapter should have been part 2.
Yeah, exactly.
I like part 2 of Resident Evil. I like part 1.
Yeah, part 1 was good. I don't know. I just...
You know why part 1 was good? Because zombie movies... were like a forgotten art. Mm-hmm. Like, I was always a fan of zombie movies since, I would say, grade 7. Before Resident Evil came out, I liked the original Night of the Living Dead. Like, I watched it. I actually bought a DVD from Dollarama when it first opened.
Oh, nice.
And had the original Night of the Living Dead, with directed by Romero, obviously the guy who is credited with creating the genre. I've always loved zombie movies, but for a long time, there was no zombie movies. Except then Resident Evil came out. It was pretty good. Even though they bastardized the story.
They did, but... You know, for
and it set the franchise somewhere stupid.
It's pretty close.
Yeah,
yeah. Umbrella.
Fucking,
cool.
I had people that were like, "Yo, look it, that bullet has umbrella. That's close to the storyline."
Yeah.
No, it isn't. Get out of here. Who's Alice? Never heard of Alice.
No, never existed. They just put additional characters that didn't need to be.
But the movie itself, I thought two was good because it was the city. They kind of merged 2 and 3 in part 2 of Resident Evil. I thought it should have ended there.
That's good. Okay.
Like, anyways, that's it from us. Nate,
Lester,
thank you for watching Retro Gaming's Most Dangerous Podcast. Comment below for any responses in today's video. Thank you guys very much for watching. Subscribe to the channel. Lester, tell them where to go.
Facebook.com/thriftdollar is the highest internet website on the internet today. Like, comment, subscribe. YouTube.com/thriftdollar. Like, comment, and subscribe. And we're out.